Hello, I'm Dr. Kait Chang, naturopathic doctor, and I am the founder of Calgary Menopause Wellness. Today we have Lee Macauley with us from Momentum Health West Springs. Lee, I know that you are a pelvic physiotherapist. Tell us what you do and what is pelvic physio?
So basically, in order to describe what a pelvic physio is, I have to describe what the pelvis is and what area that I treat. So the pelvic floor is basically a group of muscles that's like a hammock that's attached to different parts of your pelvis. Mm-hmm. So it's attached to your tailbone, your sit bones, and your pubic bone at the front. And there's a lot of conditions that can arise from dysfunction in these muscles. So the typical things that you're going to see are the muscles getting a little bit too tight or those muscles getting a little bit weak. So some of the symptoms of those, they'll affect our bowel and bladder. And they'll affect our other pelvic organs like our uterus. And so those muscles generally help to lift and support those organs. They're also helpful in regulating our bowel and bladder, and they help with appreciation of sexual intercourse. So if there's any issues with those, so the typical things that can arise is pelvic organ prolapse or bladder issues such as incontinence, or inability to fully empty your bladder, or increased urgency or frequency of going to the bathroom, pain with intercourse, to name a few. Other things like pelvic pain, anything to do around the back, the abdomen, and things like that. Mm-hmm. So a pelvic floor physio is specifically trained to deal with those conditions.
How do you know if it's a pelvic pain versus a back pain?
So that is something that you need to be doing a history and an assessment for. Okay. You'd almost have to rule out some of those things. And sometimes people have a little bit of both going on. So usually people would see me, the most common complaint is leaking urine. So usually they're going to have some issues with that, or they'll have pain with intercourse. Or I'll see people that are pregnant or postpartum and they're having some issues related to that. But leaking urine is the most common symptom that people usually seek treatment for.
Right. Mm-hmm. So somebody who would think that they would have to go to physio, they wouldn't, if they didn't know that there's pelvic physiotherapist, how would they know that they had to go to a pelvic physio? Would a physio refer them to you? Is that how it works?
Here at West Springs, we have a pretty good interdisciplinary team. So the physiotherapists, if they're seeing someone that they suspect might have some pelvic floor dysfunction, they'll often send them to see me. Mm-hmm. Usually people aren't necessarily disclosing some of those issues when you're seeing a physiotherapist because they don't know that there's treatment for it.
Right.
So oftentimes those that I see that have seen regular physiotherapists or chiropractors, it's usually because their pain hasn't resolved or they have a mixture of some of the bladder issues, bowel issues, and pain with intercourse. And then we end up treating some of the pelvic pain and some of those other things they might be experiencing.
Okay. So if somebody comes in and see you, what does your typical appointment look like?
So typically I book 75 to 90 minutes.
Okay.
And honestly, most of that time, about 45 minutes of it, is taking a history of what's going on. So we'll be talking about bowel and bladder and sex, but I also ask a lot of questions about pain, childbirth, and some of those other things because they're all relevant to what might be going on.
Mm-hmm.
After that, then we do just a typical external exam that you might see, that you might get seeing a regular physio or chiropractor. And so it's checking core strength, checking range of motion, other things like that, checking joint mobility. And then the thing that sets a pelvic physio apart from a regular physiotherapist is an internal vaginal or rectal examination.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of our gold standard. And like I said, what sets us apart, because that allows us to actually feel the pelvic floor muscles, check to see if people are doing a proper pelvic floor contraction or Kegel. We can check for pelvic organ prolapse and some of those other things that might arise that people don't realize are going on.
Yeah, from a regular physio, right?
Yeah. So once we do the internal and the external assessment, we come up with a treatment plan. So depending on what's going on, we might be doing a ton of education. That's usually the biggest thing that I do. And then some lifestyle management and then treatment. So I'll often do traditional physio treatments, so soft tissue massage, doing joint mobility things. And then I can also do internal treatments. So I'll actually release the pelvic floor muscles mm-hmm. and do a lot of cueing and retraining to strengthen those muscles. Mm-hmm. And then...
when you say, sorry, cueing and strengthening those muscles, mm-hmm. what do you mean?
So I'm able to, like, I'll be checking those muscles internally. So I use mm-hmm. one finger and I check vaginally of the contraction. So I'll have people mm-hmm. do a pelvic floor contraction.
While your finger is in their vagina.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And so most people, mm-hmm. I would say the majority of women are doing a Kegel improperly. Mm-hmm. And so if you're trying to help with incontinence, so if you cough, laugh, or sneeze and leak urine, or if mm-hmm. you can't quite make it to the bathroom and you're trying to engage those muscles, oftentimes they're doing it incorrectly. So sometimes it just takes a little bit of retraining and cueing those muscles verbally so that mm-hmm. they can learn how to engage them, which mm-hmm. can also often be helpful in helping them mm-hmm. close around that urethra to keep their urine in.
And do you see that common in menopause or perimenopause women?
Yeah, so that's quite common. So stress incontinence is a type of incontinence where if you cough, laugh, or sneeze, or there's increased pressure right. that you'll leak urine mm-hmm. or even position changes. So getting up from a chair or walking.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And then urge incontinence is that urge to go to the bathroom and you just can't quite make it and you lose control of your bladder. Okay. Mm-hmm. And so those are really common. Okay. And then pelvic organ prolapse is really common. So oftentimes I'll see that in both perimenopause and menopause, because it's usually in relation to childbirth mm. or someone who's quite overweight, just because there's extra pressure on her pelvic organs. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily people who've had a C-section, it can be, or vaginal delivery, it can also be C-section. So mm-hmm. I'll see some of those things with that. Mm-hmm.
So those were the times when somebody would come in and see you. In a menopause age range.
Yeah. The other thing that I'll see with that is pain with intercourse. So typically once mm-hmm. you're reaching menopause, your estrogen levels are dropping and that affects the lining of your vaginal wall. Mm-hmm. And the lining of your vaginal wall actually helps to support your bladder. So if that starts to thin, right. you can suffer from pelvic organ prolapse. You can also suffer from pain with intercourse because of that. If your pelvic organs are falling down and you're having penetrative intercourse, it can be painful. Mm-hmm. Or it's just painful just due to dryness and friction.
Yeah. And when do you start seeing that vaginal dryness picture in a woman's life?
It ranges. Mm-hmm. It's usually when there's going to be big hormone fluctuations. So I'll see it postpartum. That'll be one of the first times just because they might be breastfeeding or they've gone through pregnancy and there's a lot of hormone changes. And then you'll often see it, depending on the person, because some people go through menopause at different stages, but usually I'll see it in the older population. So those people that are already well into menopause.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. And would you have a lubricant that you recommend for people to use with their partners?
So there's a couple different kinds. It depends on what the person's using it for. Mm-hmm. So there's three main categories. There's water-based lubricants, there's hybrid lubricants, and there's silicone-based. So the water-based are going to be the typical ones that most people are familiar with. You can get them at the mm-hmm. drugstore. So KY is a typical water-based.
KY the brand?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. The pros to that are they're easy to get. They're not expensive. And they're safe to use with condoms and things like that. Because that's the other thing you have to consider. Are you going to be using it right. with that? Mm-hmm. It can also provide a bit of a barrier. So if people are having pain due to just dryness and increased friction, right. it can provide a bit of a barrier. Mm-hmm. However, they get really tacky and sticky and you often have to reapply. Mm-hmm. But again, they're quite easy to get. You can get them at any drugstore okay. and even Costco. You can buy them in larger amounts.
Okay.
And then there's hybrid lubricants. The drawback of these ones is you have to typically get them from a sex toy shop mm-hmm. or online. Mm-hmm. And they're kind of a hybrid between a silicone and a water-based. And mm-hmm. so they're safe to use with condoms and they're safe to use with like... if you're using sex toys, different things like that, mm-hmm. and they'll be a little bit more slippery. Mm-hmm. And then silicone-based lubricants, those ones are really, really thin. They are a little bit more comfortable to use, mm-hmm. but you have to actually clean them off. They can stain your sheets. So some people, and the same thing with that, you typically have to get them in online or at a sex toy store.
And are you worried about the silicone particles retaining in the vagina?
And that's where people have to make decisions, because if they're more comfortable with one than not the other, right, then they might want to go a more natural way. So there are natural lubricants such as coconut oil, vegetable oil,
right,
Vaseline, those types of things. However, they can be irritating,
right,
and they, you know, they can affect the pH of
yeah,
the vagina.
And it could create more opportunities for infection.
Yes, right? Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and they aren't necessarily safe to use with condoms. So if you're trying to practice safe sex, then it's not a great idea for that. But those are easily available.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, that's something people have to consider when they're choosing one.
Mm-hmm.
And you end up having to try multiple. So often trying to get like samples or smaller sizes and things like that to see if it'll work for you.
Right.
And if you're worried about irritation and things like that, you can put a little bit on your forearm, see if you have a reaction.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Those are very good tips.
Yeah.
And then we probably had covered this already. What are the top three common pelvic conditions that you see in menopause women and perimenopause women?
So this is tough because, as I said before, people are kind of going through it at different times. Most pelvic conditions are usually related to childbirth.
Mm-hmm.
You don't necessarily have to have had children, and it doesn't happen right after childbirth, but usually that's a pretty big risk factor.
Mm-hmm.
And so
things like prolapse.
Yeah. So the common three ones are going to be prolapse, incontinence, and pain with intercourse.
Mm-hmm.
And those they can typically affect people at any age, basically. The one that, like I said, is mostly reserved for menopausal women is going to be that vaginal dryness. So they'll typically have more issues with intercourse.
Okay. Do you have a set of exercises that you can show us that women can do at home to strengthen their pelvic muscles or relax their pelvic muscles?
So one of the biggest misconceptions is that we have a weak pelvic floor.
Mm-hmm.
And so a lot of people are doing tons of Kegels trying to strengthen it. And as I mentioned before, most people are doing them incorrectly.
Mm-hmm.
Or if you have a really tight pelvic floor, this can increase the tension in the pelvic floor muscles and actually cause more issues with it. Tight pelvic floor is usually, those people typically have stress incontinence, pain with intercourse, can't fully empty their bladder, different things like that. So if you're doing a bunch of Kegels, you might be making things a bit worse.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're not sure and you want to try some, the best way to do that would be to, if you think about your pelvic floor like a diamond, the top would be your pubic bone, the sides are your sit bones,
mm-hmm.
and the bottom is your tailbone. You're trying to engage all of those muscles together. What people typically do is they engage around their rectum. So they'll engage those muscles, but not the rest of their pelvic
mm-hmm.
floor.
Mm-hmm.
So again, if you're trying to hold in P and you're missing the muscle that actually closes around your urethra, that might be part of the issue. So the best way to do a Kegel is to think about that diamond, and I'll have a patient go through engaging the front. So it's almost like you're going P and stopping mid-flow.
Mm-hmm.
Another cue that I'll use is trying to suck up a grain of rice
mm-hmm.
to engage that front part. And that's the one, that's also a trick that I use for people if they feel like they have a strong urge to go, or they think they might leak urine if they're coughing or sneezing.
Right.
We call that the lock or the neck, and I'll have them forcefully engage that front muscle.
Mm-hmm.
So that can be really helpful. And if you're going to do a Kegel, then you would do that front muscle and then the middle muscle between the sit bones. And that's done by trying to imagine that you're sucking up a ping pong ball through your
mm-hmm.
vagina.
Mm-hmm.
And then the back part around the tailbone is, again, squeezing around your rectum or trying to lift your tailbone.
Mm-hmm.
Then you combine those together. So you would be doing the front muscle, the middle muscle, and the back muscle all together.
Mm-hmm.
And that would be a proper Kegel.
Right.
But if you think you might have some issues related to a tight pelvic floor,
mm-hmm.
then I typically discontinue Kegels for those person and
right.
those people. That might be an indication that you do need to see someone for treatment
right.
because we can release those muscles.
So for someone who's trying to practice more Kegel but doing it erroneously, they could be contracting just the rectal part, like the hind
mm-hmm.
part, and that can cause things like constipation, tailbone pain,
mm-hmm.
And anything else? If you're doing Kegel the wrong way.
Yeah. The other thing too is a lot of people will do them all day, all the time. So they'll do them when they're sitting in the car, when they're standing in line, but general strengthening principles, you need to give those muscles a break. You also need to fully relax them. So I'll often have people follow with some stretches and do some things like that
mm-hmm.
and almost do it in a planned exercise session versus just engaging them all the time, because you wouldn't do that with any other muscle. Right. So you want to make sure a tight pelvic floor isn't a healthy pelvic floor. You want it to be strong and flexible. Mm-hmm. So be able to fully relax and engage when you kind of need it.
Okay.
So typically, if I'm sensing someone has a tight pelvic floor and then I check internally and it is, I often don't give them Kegels to do. And we eventually get back to them, because usually a tight muscle is also weak, mm-hmm. but we need to release it and retrain that.
Mm-hmm.
And then the exercises for prolapse, I'll have people do Kegels if they need to, because typically our pelvic muscles aren't helping to support those organs.
Mm-hmm.
And then we do a resting position for that. And then for incontinence, there's some bladder training as well.
Okay. So it can be quite extensive coming to see you, going through all these exercises, not understanding why I'm doing these exercises. Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. Okay. Before I let you show us the exercise that you highly recommend,
mm-hmm.
I want to know, where can we find more about your work?
So right now I'm currently just at our West Springs location.
Uh-huh.
And you can contact us through the website or by calling.
Right.
But generally I don't have anything on social media or anything like that.
Okay.
But I do free 30-minute in-person or phone consults.
Okay.
So that can usually be helpful for people.
Okay.
And when they do see me, I provide, I have quite a few handouts of all the exercises and a lot of educational resources.
Mm-hmm.
And honestly, the majority of the treatment and the sessions are educating people about a lot of these issues.
Well, talking about sessions, how many sessions do you think somebody coming in to see you for any conditions will require to get through their, or get over their pain or discomfort?
So generally, if it's just purely incontinence,
mm-hmm.
oftentimes that's only anywhere from like 2 to 3 visits.
Okay.
And often we can resolve it in that amount of time.
Mm-hmm.
Pelvic organ prolapse is typically anywhere from 3 to 5.
Mm-hmm.
Pelvic pain gets tricky because if they're needing ongoing treatment, sometimes I'll refer them to some of our other physiotherapists once we've resolved some of the pelvic floor issues. But generally, those people are going to be more like the 8 to 10. Usually people have a mixture of everything, so sometimes it's hard to gauge what's going on, but we'll typically see how they do with some of the treatments.
So you're meeting where they are. Here.
Yeah. Yeah. But the average is about 3 to 5.
Okay. Three to five.
For most conditions.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. So we'll go ahead and have you show us those exercises.
Okay.